I always told him that the story really started in the ditch at the side of the tracks. And that the details, which I promised never to reveal to anyone, are painful and shocking, as the details often are. But the fact of the matter is that Clevenger did forget, and now he's dead. So, perhaps the time has finally come for me to tell the tale and have done with it. It was late December, and I hadn't seen the swing for weeks. Usually it wouldn't bother me too much, but the downstairs kin had begun the march of the hypocrites. Having dug the prime number once too often, they were jonesing for a heavy dose of mahjong. And I'm afraid I was going to take the fall if I didn't raise the paper in a hurry. It was only one or two, so I decided to head out on my broom and sweep the city clean until I had fully dug the destiny of my swingy swing, to see if she had realized the neutral categories of error or simply goofed to Whig City. If so, I knew it was going to be a sad drag from here on out. First off, I made for the Tappy Apple, a jive box straight out of Night Gallery, where sweaty couples writhed under heat lamps to the crazy, lumbering rhythms of a band that dressed in frilly fuchsia tuxedos and sounded like Desi Arnaz on some kind of psychedelic ballet. 13 was behind the bar, and I sounded him to dig if he had seen the swing lately, but he couldn't recall right away. So I drew him a picture, but he couldn't hear it. I decided to swoop the scene and fly to Wicker, Swing's old neighborhood. There zero in on a club called the Magneto, where I'd heard they'd served a drink Swing'd invented called a pilot light. A sweet little taste at first, but a brain bender later on. Hot enough to take any chump, chumpy enough to try it, straight to the burning at Ashtabula Bridge. That was when I bumped into 47. Old 47. Tanked up on the bean as usual and feeling no pain from the morphine he'd had for lunch that day, lit up like a fuse at the mention of Swing's tag and vouchsafed to me that he had the bushy tail to come along. Now I knew that 47 had long since relegated his routine synapse dues to the 13th quadrant of his subconscious mind, but he never wigged on me, and I knew if I flopped in a puddle 3 feet deep somewhere along the way, he might just be the worthy stud to help pull me out and wipe off the jam. I said, "I think I hear the fat lady." 47 concurred explicitly, and we tuned out. On the way out, we nearly tripped over an alley cat blowing his modes for chump change. Mama always told me to stay away from a man in his modal stage, so I made like I was fresh out of paper in hopes that the troll would let us pass without the toll. But he was hip to the scene and began riding roughshod over moment's notice. He took a drive, hit a ghost, lost his head, now he's toast. Later we dug from Shorty George that the cat had bugged to the way outer sphere some years ago, so no mea culpa there, thank God. We decided to stop in at the Diner Grill and dig Marty and Steve and the Baldy Dinerhead crowd, shooting craps over the last few slices of the day's ham hocks. "Here we divide the plunder," cried Huey. "As a young girl goes to the bridal chamber," Billy S. replied, "so go I to the grill with this tasty morsel." Pork went up and smacked them both for brutalizing the species. Suddenly, in walked Swing and gassed the whole sphere with her indelible groovitude. "Bonsoir, Kurtzkies," said she. "It's sunset time, and I've got the moon chariot to prove it." I dug through the eyes and glass the sweetest little ride I'd ever seen. Swing smiled that sly smile of hers, and we tuned out. It's been that way ever since. Just Swing, 47, and moi in a beauty spin all across the hemisphere. Never mind the kin, we are gone, Kith. Solid gone.